back to Ishmael. And then Sarah has thrown Hagar away. Under normal condition, nobody will care. Kill her, if possible, destroy her. It's verse 17 here. Then God heard the boy crying. And the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What is the matter, Hagar? Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Lift the boy up and take him by the hand, for I will make him a great nation." Again, you see the capacity of God to be compassionate. The capacity of God not to allow a man's guilt to crush him, or a man's failure to turn fatal. And this was somebody who would have been a way out condemned. But God says, "Look, I will make him a great nation. I will deliver him. I will support him." That shows that God has never desired that his people should be ashamed. You and I know the story of the prodigal son. In the prodigal son, we learned that this boy had done terrible things. He's been rude to his father. He's gone out of the way of his father. But when he came, the Bible says, "This our son who was lost is now found. Let us kill him, the father's cow." That shows God never wants us to be ashamed. Isaiah was talking about God and says, "For your shame, you shall have a double honor." In a sense, whenever you are ashamed, or whenever things make you very unhappy and sad, God wants to give you a great honor. But today, my brethren, it's not just saying you will not be ashamed. Oh, you shall not be ashamed. All of us say, "Amen, we shall not be ashamed." But there are biblical principles which we shall begin to look at if we must not be ashamed. God wants us to be competitive in the world we live in. God wants us to be glorious in the world we live in. God wants us to shine as light in the world we live in. God wants us to be witness of his great work in the world we live in. God doesn't want us to lock ourselves in the room because we cannot compete in the world. God doesn't want us to look aloof when we should be leading with people. God doesn't want us to remain very shy and withdrawn, that we're not able to say our minds. Psychologists tell us that timid people will not be as successful as assertive people. 60% of timid people will never get to their potential. 60% of timid people will never be in the high echelon of the society. 60% of timid people will be downtrodden by those who are courageous and assertive. And that is why the Bible says God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of love, and a spirit of power, and a spirit of sound mind. I want to say that the first principle we must keep in mind, if we must never be ashamed, we must, as children of God, fill our hearts with the love of God. As this year opens, you must come to the consciousness that God loves you. You see, it's so fundamental in Scripture that God loves you. Jeremiah said in the book of Jeremiah 31 verse 3, he says, "God loves us with an everlasting love." God loves us with an everlasting love. When the Greek writers were trying to translate the Bible from the original, they had no other word to express the love of God than to use the word agape or agapan. Means with a love that transcends human comprehension. A love that cannot be explained. And Jesus put it this way, that God loves us even while we were yet sinners. Even while we were yet sinners. And so, my friend, don't think that God loves you because you are doing something good. Don't think that God loves you because you are doing something right. God loves you because of his capacity to love. John tells us that God is love. He also told us, I said, what a marvelous secret that we have, that God has so much manifested his love upon us that we should be called the sons of God. Jesus says, "Greater love can no man give than this, that a man should lay his life for his friends. And so if you are going to have a great self-esteem, if you are not going to be ashamed this year, you must recognize that God really loves you. God cares for you. The Bible says in John 3:16, God so loved the world. The Bible says in 1 John 3:16, 3:16 again, he gave up his life for us. John 3:16 says he so loved the world. 1 John 3:16 says he gave up his life for us. Paul told the Ephesian church that the love that God has for us is a love that passeth knowledge. Is a love that passeth knowledge. And so you must get that flood in your soul that you don't need to dress in a particular manner. You don't need to look in a particular way. You don't need to have prayer and fasting sessions before God can love you. You don't need to carry a cross before God can love you. God truly loves you. The Bible tells us in Romans 13:10 that love worketh no ill, and love is the fulfillment of the law. Love worketh no ill. Love is the fulfillment of the law. I want us to realize that if you are not going to be ashamed, just look at everything that is happening around you. Look at everything that is happening in your home. Look at all your unanswered prayers. And then come to that consciousness in yourself that God loves me. If we turn to the book of Romans chapter 8, we see another thing clear about love. Paul kept on asking a question in verse 31. He talked about all the things that will happen to us, all the difficulties that we go through. Then he asks a simple question. What then shall we say in response to this? Sometimes somebody may want you to feel that God doesn't love you because you've not got the promotion you are looking for, because you've not got the spouse you are looking for. You see, one of the major things I understood as a young Christian is the fact that all those who come around you to give you opinion about your situation do not hear from God. When you are not writing a card, they will come to you, oh, what is it? Why is God doing this to you? When you are trusting God for healing, they say, go just 7 days prayer and fasting. 7 days prayer and fasting. At the end of 7 days, the sickness will disappear. I've always told people that your relationship to God is not an emergency affair. God does not operate with you in a panic measure. It's a process. He treats you as a son, not just an event. And so when people come around me or come around you to paint a picture of if your life is difficult, as if it's painful. Somebody came to me some time ago, I was praying, he's praying and crying. I said, why are you crying? He said, what is happening to you? I said, what is happening to you that is crying? You that are facing the situation, I'm not crying. I said, why do I have to cry? Because I know that God loves me. And everything about my life has been written in the book of God. And that even though I go through turbulent situations and turbulent weather, weeping may last just for a night, but joy comes in the dawn. Every friend that counseled Job was in the wrong. The reason is that they look at the situation from the outward, and they don't look at the overall plan of God, and they never forget the statement of God. I said, test God, and you will prove that the end of God is good. Why do people go to mountaintop 40 days and 40 nights? Why do crowds of people go to a particular place looking for prayer resource? I know of a particular woman who was being attended to as one of my patients. And I told this woman, just believe God as I believe God with you. As I give you this medication, believe God. She said, no, she wouldn't. That he's told of a rally, a place of healing. And I should excuse her to go. I said, my dear, I don't know of any mountain that God doesn't appear. I don't know of any mountain that the grace of God is not seen. I don't know of any valley that is so deep that God cannot see through. I said, you don't even need to go to that valley. It would be cruel for any God to allow you to go with this, your asthma attack, all the way to that mountain top. She never listened to me. The rest is history. As she got to the camp, she died. And I felt there wasn't any reason for that. It's a reason that believes that there's going to be an anointing somewhere together. Yes, Christians should go to gather together in certain places for prayer. God sometimes brings great men of God into the scene that we need to listen to them. But the issue is not those men. The issue is not those mountains. The issue is a God that answers prayers. And so I want you, my friend, as Paul wrote, he says, what can we say to all these things? What can we say to all these things that is going around us? What can we say to these problems that you are going through? What can we say to the unanswered prayer that you seem to have had? What can we say to the difficulties you face? And I say it very clearly, if God be for us, who can be against us? That summarizes it. Then he went further and says, I am convinced, I am persuaded, neither height, neither depth, nor anything else in this creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That is what the Bible is all about. Paul talked of about the people who wanted to use the law to attain righteousness. And rather than attaining to righteousness, they saw a stumbling block. And again, the people that believed by faith and they obtained a righteousness. And through them, God says, they will never be ashamed. And so please, no matter how long you go for an exam and you don't pass. So please, no matter how long you pray that God should meet your request and you don't have an answer. The answers are in the book. And as far as God is concerned, ignore the process and look at the destination. When the process becomes so complicated and confusing, ignore it. And just believe that, well, all said and done, I have only one summary, God loves me. Romans 5, chapter 5, brings this a bit clearer to us. From verse 3, it says, not only so, but we also rejoice in the sufferings, because we know the suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance produces character. And we know that character brings what? Hope. Why does it bring hope? And hope does not disappoint. Hope does not make us ashamed. Why? Because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Hope does not disappoint. Hope does not disappoint. One Bible put it this way, my people shall not be dealt a heavy blow. My people shall not be dealt a heavy blow. Why? Because the love of God floods our hearts. And so if you are not going to be ashamed this year, I want you to always consistently believe that you are surrounded by love. Although your father may not have loved you, although your mother may have been negligent when you were growing up, although your husband does not appreciate you, or your wife doesn't see anything good in you, although your parents are always nagging you and nagging you all the time, but just come to that consciousness that is a supreme being that supersedes all men and is in control of all events, and continually flood yourself in the love of God. When pains take you in the face, our sufferings try to hold a clenching hand upon you, when disappointment rains after you as if it's going to overflow you, look at those things in the face and say, what can I say to all this? What is my comment to all this? What is my comment to the boss who refuses to give me, listen to me? What is my comment to that exam I have not passed? What is my comment to that prayer that has not been answered? What is my comment to those economic situations that I'm facing? If God be for me, who can be against me? Then if all these things are not against me, then God is using them. They are tools in the hands of God. They are agents in the hands of God. They are armies in the hands of God's great project. And as far as I'm concerned, today it may be devastation, but tomorrow is going to be joy. For my hope shall not be disappointed. Second thing I want us to say before I round up for today is that if we are not going to be ashamed, we must learn to love ourselves. I told you of many people who look at themselves in the mirror and curse the day the Lord decided to make them like they are. I know many people who look at their successes and say, well, how has God created my situation like that? You see, I've come to find out that there are no situations that are perfect. What happens is that they are very good public relations officers. A man who is a very good public relations officer publicizes his own so perfect that you think it's all good. But dig into that man's life, and you find out that there is a lot of in him that will make you feel that you are better than him. What you see in people flouted is their best. They don't tell you what their sorrows, they don't tell you their pains. Somebody came to me some time ago and said, oh, look, he went to meet a family. He said, what a wonderful family. He saw the husband and wife, he stayed with them, there was no quarrel. He said, how I wish we can learn from this family. How I wish Christians can learn from this family. So unless he should tell me a lot about the family. He kept on telling me. Then I pointed the family to me. I said, let's go and visit them. So when we visited the man, and we asked the man, how is your wife? He said, which one are you talking about? You must learn not to look down on yourself. Don't concentrate on your limitations. Always say to yourself that you are fearfully and you are wonderfully made. You see, you are your best psychologist. You are your best therapist. No one else in this world can help you out. People tell us that the internal dialogue people give to themselves sooner or later become an outward roar. In a sense, the way you feel inside of you, what you tell yourself every day, will suddenly become what everybody will know about you. Take time to talk to yourself. David did it many times. He said, why art thou cast down, O my soul? Hope thou in God, for he is thy help and the health of thy countenance. Sit yourself down and begin to encourage yourself. Yes, you may have not walked the way your peers walked. You may have not got the degrees your peers have got. You may not have been prominent as your people, but there are certain things that God has put into you. Everyone created by God has been given a winning tool for which he can triumph and excel. So write a love letter to yourself. Send an email to yourself. Begin to give yourself that encouragement that yourself needs. Somebody says, nobody encourages me. You have to encourage yourself. And that's why the Bible says, love your neighbor as yourself. And the book of Ephesians tells us, no one does ill to himself, but he cherishes it and nurses himself. So cherish yourself. Nurse yourself. Thank God for yourself. Thank God for the good things that God is doing for your life. If there's anything I've learned as a child of God, if anything I've learned as a pastor, is that people are different. And that people are distinct. And the people are good in their own sense. Each time I look at people, a vast array of people, I begin to appreciate God for making us different. I begin to appreciate God for the good things he has done in making us what we are. So my friend, don't lock yourself up and say you are not good enough. I will not go to lectures because nobody likes me. I will not go to church because I don't have a good dress. I will not go to that social gathering because nobody likes me. I will not go to that family meeting because I look like an obscure person. I have long gone the family lineage. I'm the only one that has not succeeded. No. As far as God is concerned, the expectation of the righteous shall be made. And so I want to tell you, fight those impulses in yourself. Fight those internal dialogue in yourself that tells you are not a winner, that tells you are defeated, that tells you are not worth it, that tells you will not make it. Rather, magnify what God has done in your life. Say to yourself that God loves you. And because God loves you, you are a great person. You are a wonderful person. You are fearfully and you are wonderfully made. And God's plan for you will never miss a day. When you do that, then your body has encouragement. Your soul has encouragement. Your spirit has encouragement. Look at Jesus Christ. If Jesus Christ was not talking to himself, he was stripped naked. He came to his own and his own refused him. But each time Jesus had an encouragement in himself, he recognized, he called himself the Son of Man. He said, I and the Father are one. He knew what he was, although he thought less of himself. But he was never lost of what God has created in him, what God has made him. So this year, if we are not going to be ashamed, I want you to flood yourself with the love of God. If you are not going to be ashamed, I want you to flood yourself with the love, the real love that God has given you. Don't lock yourself. Don't look down on yourself. Don't allow yourself to begin to believe that you cannot make it. Don't allow other people flaunting their degrees, flaunting their accomplishments, showing their cars, talking about their families, talking about their great thing God has done for them, make you feel you are diminished. You cannot do it. No. Your time is coming. The processes of God may be slow, but the process of God runs smooth. The plan of God may be delayed, but the plan of God can never be denied. Can we pray? I want you to bow your heads wherever you are. I want you to thank the Lord. For those of you watching me on television, we started by saying the love of God. I don't know if you have responded to that love. I don't know if you have told God, come into my life. You love me and I love you. Just yield yourself to God this morning. Tell him to be the Lord of your life. Those of you are watching me on television or listening to me here, if you don't know Jesus Christ, if you have not come to the knowledge of the truth which is in Christ, I want you to tell the Lord, come into my life, be my Lord and Savior. Because God loves you. He doesn't love your sin. He doesn't love your waywardness. He doesn't love your backsliding. But he wants to turn your shame unto glory. And so you have to tell God, I don't want to live the way I'm living. I don't want to continue the way I'm doing things. God, I will receive you into my life. And for those of us as children of God, let's encourage ourselves this morning. Let's encourage our family members. Let's encourage our spouses. Let us encourage our friends. Let us encourage as many people that God brings around us. Let us go on with this great sense that God loves us. And if God loves us, nothing good can he withhold from us. Father, I thank you this morning. I thank you for the grace of God. I thank you that you have shown us that this year we shall not be ashamed. And so I speak this word of prophecy to every man and every woman who has felt ashamed in the year 29, who has felt ashamed because they have not met up, who has felt ashamed because their prayers have not been answered, who has felt ashamed because they haven't got even the food to eat or the clothes to wear, who have felt ashamed because there's no shelter upon them, who has felt ashamed because of their physical appearance or the illness they have, who has felt ashamed because they have failed you and they have been covered with shame. This morning I pray that you will grant unto them the spirit to recognize that you love them and you want them to be close to you and you want them to come back to you and you want them to fall forward in you. I pray, Lord, that they will receive inner strength, inner power,